את יודעת שהשם חקשורי בעולם הטניס הישראלי הוא שם דבר. המשפחה הזאת וראש השבט, הוא יושב איתנו כאן, ססון חקשורי. הלו, סיר.
היי.
מה נשמע?
תודה לאל.
מי שלא מכיר, האיש הזה היה, בוא נגיד, המוח וגם המבצע מאחורי הקרמלין קאפ, הטורניר ההוא שהגיע בתחילת שנות ה-90 לברית המועצות, הסגורה והמסוגרת. מה שבזמנו נראה כפרויקט חסר סיכוי, וגם נשמע על זה תכף. זה ושאר הדברים בספר שבדרך. Is the book ready or not yet?
Soon.
Soon. You are writing it nowadays with Tamar, who is helping you?
Indeed, yes.
Okay,
Does it have a name already?
Pardon?
Do you have a name for your book already?
Not yet.
Not yet, okay.
It's not only about tennis. It's general about my life, and there is a session of tennis.
I will give you ideas. I'm good with this.
Yeah.
I will help you.
But kind of you.
We are focused on tennis because some of the stories that we've read in the first draft are amazing. And we would like you to share, because not many of our viewers know what you're talking about. So take us to the beginning, your initial idea to start a tournament in Russia.
Right.
Soviet Union.
Yes. You know, since 1962, I used to travel to Moscow in average monthly once.
For business?
To Soviet Union, for business, for carpet business. And of course, I was a tennis fan and I like tennis. And we were watching, during our business also, sometimes we are watching how Andrei Chesnokov and Andrei Cherkasov are playing and their results and so. And I was really very, very impressed. Till someone says, Mr. Khakshouri, why you are not going to organize a tennis tournament in Moscow? And I was so naive. I didn't have any clue what does mean to organize a tennis tournament. And I started to be involved, and I had luck. I knew Mr. Ian Fruman. Dr. Ian Fruman, the founder of Tennis Center. I approached to him, he took me to New York. We met Eugene Scott, a legend of tennis.
Scott was a great player.
Yes, yes.
And quick moment to translate.
Right.
אז מדבר כאן ססון חקשורי על העובדה שהוא היה מגיע למוסקווה בלאו הכי, בערך פעם בחודש בעסקי השטיחים. כאיש עסקים, ועל כך שהוא עקב גם אחרי שחקנים כמו צ'סנקוב, שהיה בסיאו 13 בעולם, שחקן בעל שם, ובאיזשהו שלב, בשיחות ובקשרים האלה, גם פנו אליו, שאלו אותו, למה שלא תעשה כאן טורניר ATP, ובנאיביות הוא אמר,
לא
יאללה,
לא היה לו מושג
מה, במה זה כרוך. נזכיר רק שהנושא הזה ורבים אחרים עולים בספר שמגובש בימים אלה, שהוא כותב ביחד עם תמר אלעם גינדין, שדוברת את השפה הפרסית, וגם אני מניח שחלק מזה קשור בספר.
How long did it take to turn the simple idea, the naive idea maybe, into reality? Because I'm sure there were some difficulties and obstacles on the way.
Unbelievable. It took 3 years. 3 years, but 10 years of my life. Made it shorter.
But what were the difficulties?
I didn't know that to organize a tennis tournament so complicated. I approached to a pro serve company who they used to organize the tournament, and they asked me, what for do you want to organize tennis tournament in Moscow? You want to have a free of charge a ticket? We can provide you. But what else? And I was very insulted.
Maybe the biggest problem is it's a country or not even a country, but the Soviet Union and the communist idea was dying back then.
Right.
So this was a country bleeding. At the same time, wanted to show a different face and very corrupt. So all this potentially has many problems for a sporting event.
Yeah. I tell you, due my experience in Russia, I realized that the Russian nation are very, very talented in sport. You know, one of the advantages of communist system was that there were two things free of charge, education and sport. You could do sport and you could be member everywhere without pay anything, same in school and university. And as I was traveling inside of Moscow, in metro, you know, metro, mm-hmm. Moscow metro is one of the most beautiful metro in the world. Every station is like castle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I was amazed in the train to see 90% of the people who are going to work or coming back, they have a book and they are studying. Yeah. And
you were impressed by this?
Very impressed, and most of them athletic, very, very good shape. And really, I loved them very much, and I saw...
Quick translation, 3 years זה לקח לארגן, 10 years מחיי, okay. אומר לנו ססון חקשורי. אין מה לעשות, לא הבנו בכלל לאן אנחנו נכנסים, זו הייתה מדינה שמצד אחד באמת יש בה כישורים אתלטיים, כמו שאנחנו יודעים, כי החינוך והספורט היה בחינם. Mm-hmm. מצד שני, יש בעיות קיימות. למשל, כשרציתי בהתחלה לארגן את הדבר הזה, החברה המארגנת אמרה לי, אתה רוצה בסך הכל כרטיס, והוא נורא נעלב מזה, כי הרעיון היה באמת לעשות את הדבר הזה בצורה הטובה ביותר. I want to ask you about the first few weeks before the first tournament.
Right.
Because you had insane difficulties. Let's start with food, for example. What did you do to solve the food problem?
Well, I knew that it's a huge problem, you know. During this time, just to buy bread, butter, and so, they were a queue of the people to...
Or black market.
Or black market.
So you had to bring from Switzerland?
Yes, so we brought a whole group from 5-star hotel, Hotel Zurich, mm-hmm. with all staff, all cooks and waiters. And as we came to Moscow, the Moscow people for catering, they were very insulted. They say, what are you crazy? We have everything.
We have borscht,
yes. And we have everything. Are you crazy? What the Swiss people have to offer us that we don't know? And it took 2-3 days as they saw how the Swiss catering is working, how is clean, how everything is.
And you were moving back in the day under surveillance the whole time because there was a suspicion that you might be a spy.
Everything, yeah, sure.
It's unbelievable.
So
you know, by opening day, we were celebrating the opening of Kremlin Cup, and in Red Square was demonstration, and everyone said it's going to be another revolution. And who knows how many people will be killed.
רק נתרגם את הקטע הזה, שמתכננים טורניר מהסוג הזה, אז יש בעיה למשל אוכל, אין אוכל. עושים חשבו שהם יכולים לארגן הכל, אבל השחקנים צריכים לקבל איזושהי תזונה מסוימת. היה צריך להביא קייטרינג א' משוויץ, ואז הם נורא נעלבו, וגם הדינמיקה הזאת. והכל כל הזמן תחת מעקב, שהוא אולי מרגל. ובאותו הזמן בכיכר האדומה מתחילה הפגנה ואומרים אוקיי יכולה להיות פה מהפכה ואולי יהרגו אנשים בלי סוף. מדהים.
What is the most special memory that you have from the first Kremlin Cup?
Exactly. Very good question. You know, everyone in Moscow was asking, who is this crazy guy who want to provide tennis tournament? People, they don't have to eat, to drink, and so who cares about tennis? And, you know, by opening ceremony, the Prime Minister came and in the site of Olympic Stadium, there were maybe only 200 crowds, not more. And from these 200, 100 were my friends and family, completely empty. And we were really shocked what to do. We made later a meeting how to challenge people
to come
to watch tennis. So we made the announcement, everyone who is coming to watch tennis will get a package of aspirin.
Wow. Nowadays, this seems crazy. Yeah. You could be arrested for this after so many years. אבל הרעיון היה פשוט להציע אספירין, בגלל שהטורניר
הראשון,
הטורניר היה ריק, לא בא כלב. ועל כן הציעו לאנשים קופסת אספירין, מה שהיה לא אפשרי להשגה.
שוב, אז, בימים ההם, כמובן.
אני אגיד ש... Today I would not recommend you to do the same anywhere on earth, because you will be arrested for sure.
So,
but there was another
crazy story.
Side story, is that back in the day, and nowadays it's still the same, you have to pay special players to come to your tournament.
Yes.
And you had a personal favorite, maybe you will, maybe one day you'll tell me who he is, but in the book it's not written, and he lost in the first round match. I think.
Yes.
And then he told you the following story.
Yeah. He was my I was his biggest fan. It's not a secret, it's Amos Mansour.
It's Amos?
Right.
Oh my god. I thought you would never tell us.
And I have to thank him. The idea of Kremlin Cup, maybe 20% came off through him, because I was following him everywhere, in Davis Cup or on a regular tournament. I was his fan and supporter. And I asked him if he will participate in Kremlin Cup. He accepted, and also Gilad Blum. Two guys, and it's unbelievable. First round, Amos had to play Gilad Blum.
Huh?
Yeah.
And he lost easily.
Wow. Head to head.
But is it the same story when you went to that player and asked him what happened? He told you about last night?
Yeah.
Okay.
אוקיי, אז את זה אני כבר אספר אולי.
אתה תספר?
לא יודע, can I say it?
No,
no,
no.
Not this part? אוקיי, so in the book. In the book.
מי שרוצה ש...
בכל מקרה, אני אוותר על החלק האחרון. אז כן, אז היה צריך לעד, זה...
הוא מדהים. אבל גם לשאלתך, דיברנו על זה לפני התוכנית, אם היו ישראלים.
כן.
אז הנה, הצליח להביא את הניסיון מזכיינים גם לשם, את מנסדרוף שהריץ אותו, שהוא הריץ אותו כשחקן, ואת גלעד בלום, והרצה הגורל, והם נפגשו ראש בראש במשחק הראשון.
כן, כן. מיסטר חקשורי, last question about נובק ג'וקוביץ', because you were with this guy from the get-go, from the first years where he was not even known in the tennis world, and at a certain point you stopped. What happened there?
This was my son.
Yeah, but you the crew, the Israeli crew with Ronen Bega also, and Amit Naor was the agent. What happened there?
Well, you know, it's actually by all profi tennis players, they like to have changes. And, you know, I don't know except Roger Federer and maybe one or two tennis player that they remain stable and... you know, they change a lot, no matter the relationship with family, relationship with the coach, with sponsors.
Yeah, so that's what happened.
Yeah.
Mr. Khakshouri, it's fascinating, and I promise I will give Tamar a few ideas for the
and we're gonna read the book, of course.
But I want to read it when it's out, because it was very interesting for us to read the stories about Russia. And thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Chanukah Sameach.
Chanukah Sameach.
Chanukah Sameach, tzodek.